Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the Distinguished Lecture Series. My name is Miriam Cassius, Research Development Specialist at Children's Specialized Hospital. Children's Specialized Hospital is the nation's leading provider of inpatient and outpatient care for children from birth to 21 years of age with special health care needs such as chronic illnesses and complex physical disabilities to developmental and behavioral issues. The Distinguished Lecture Series provides opportunities for researchers to present on various topics affecting healthcare. We're very excited today to host this discussion on health equity with Dr. Bob Atkins. But before we begin, we're interested in learning more about you, so please take a minute to answer the following poll, which I'm going to launch right now. Okay. Is the poll visible to everybody? Let me see, I think we may have a, okay, great, the poll is up. So please answer the poll, and while you're doing that, please note that Dr. Atkins has no conflict of interest to report. All attendees have been muted, and there is time reserved at the end for a Q&A session. Please submit your questions via the question feature, not the chat feature, and we'll address as many as possible during our Q&A session. Also, please remember to fill out the post-webinar survey. The webinar is being recorded, and the recording will be posted on our website. And today's slides and other materials are available in the handout section of your screen. Okay, so let me close the poll now. So let's see. Okay. All right. So the question was, did you do volunteer work in the last year? And where did you do it? So we have, yeah, the plurality, 35% of our attendees, they volunteered at a school or educational program that was followed by a youth group. And then third, a political group or labor union. Okay, thank you. Oops. Okay. I think that's it. So let me close the poll. Looks like I'm closing. All right. Okay, so without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Bob Atkins. Bob is director of New Jersey Health Initiatives, which is the statewide grant-making program for the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And he is also an associate professor at Rutgers University with a joint appointment in nursing and childhood studies. He co-founded the Camden Star Program, which is a nonprofit youth development program dedicated to improving the life chances of youth living in Camden, New Jersey. Bob leverages his experience as a former school nurse in the city of Camden, researcher and grant maker, to discuss the obstacles to health equity in communities of greatest needs. Bob is a lifelong New Jersey resident and is committed to building healthier communities across the state through effective collaborations and partnerships, meaningful conversations across sectors, and evidence-based innovations. Bob's most recent work as a funder and scholar has sought to increase opportunities for youth living in distressed communities to develop leadership skills and civic habits. I will now turn it over to Dr. Bob Atkins.
Thanks, Miriam. Can you hear me okay?
Yes. I don't see your screen. One moment. Sorry, having a little bit of difficulty here. Okay.
Can you see my screen?
I don't see your screen. Yeah, I'm currently the presenter, but let me try to make you presenter. Okay, here we go. Sorry. You're now presenter, Bob.
Okay. Got my screen. Now you can see my screen?
Yes, I do.
Yes.
Oh, no, actually, please put it in slideshow mode.
Here. Sorry for all this. Mm-hmm. My screen. How about now?
It's still, yeah. No, I see it in the two screens.
Okay, let me see. How about now?
Perfect. Please continue.
All right, thank you. It's a pleasure. I really appreciate the invitation to present. I really want to thank Dr. Miriam Cassius and Dr. Jill Harris and Claire Marchetta for all their help in preparing this and getting this together and helping get my thoughts together around what would be of most value in the time that I have to address you and talk about health equity. As Miriam introduced me, I have the pleasure and privilege of directing New Jersey Health Initiatives, which is a statewide grant-making program of the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. And in the next few minutes, I'd really like to focus on some of the health equity challenges we have in the state of New Jersey. The foundation is very concerned and focused on addressing health equity and talk about some of the work that I've done with the youth groups around this idea of health equity, thinking about closing the equity gap in funding and any questions or discussions that we can get into. I like to always show something that's personal to me in my talk. So this is my youngest son drinking from a hose. Clean water. He has the opportunity to do that. And I think that's something that we seek to have for all of our children across the state and across the nation. Most of you probably know, several years ago, the foundation embarked on this really ambitious plan, which was to build a culture of health. And at the center of that is really this idea of equity. And equity is all about creating opportunity. And what the foundation really tried to do was move away from how we typically think about health. And that, of course, involves all of you as providers and healthcare systems and public health. And as Miriam mentioned, I'm a nurse and I was a school nurse. And I've always been part of health conversations. But really, as we move from a culture of healthcare to a culture of health, you understood that we had to take the health conversation and move it to where we work, play, live, and learn, and really think about engaging new voices in the conversation and new sectors, and really think about how do we change this, and how do we really adapt to these new challenges that we're having? Because we have been at this for a while, and we know that our health wasn't really improving. So it was something that was ambitious and bold, but we really recognize it as an adaptive challenge. And when we think about adaptive challenges, it really centers on us thinking about a couple things. One, we really have to think about the relationships and roles that we typically have, what we value, what we believe, and how we approach our work. Second thing was really thinking about how do we work across organizational boundaries? How do we engage new voices and sectors? And so at the center, like I said, the center of what the foundation was thinking about was really thinking about how do we bring others into this conversation and not make it so exclusive and so siloed? And how do we take risk and experiment and really think about solutions that require diversity of ideas and diversity of thought and diversity of ways of working together, and realizing that this won't happen overnight, but it really is at the center of taking risk is what the philanthropy should be doing. Philanthropy is one of the only sectors that we have in society that is really set up to take risk, has resources to take risk. It doesn't have a bottom line. In contrast to what happens in healthcare systems, these aren't really life or death situations necessarily. So it was really great that the Robert Johnson Foundation really thought about this and really kind of leaned into it. So again, at the center of this is really thinking about how do we go upstream, right? I mean, a lot of things happen downstream. Obviously that's where healthcare systems are, downstream. Things are already kind of priced in, they're baked in. A lot of what we're trying to do is downstream is address right, chronic illnesses, injuries, acute illnesses. We're always going to have to think about those issues. But the foundation is really trying to get it set around it. How do we think about what happens upstream, and how do we get these new voices into the conversation? How do we create these opportunities? And part of that is investing more resources where we work, play, live, and learn. And so that's really kind of moving around and thinking expansively about how we address the health challenges, but also thinking about how do we move the pieces around and start these ideas really moving around to engage others in this thought process. And when we really go in the community, when we work in the community, we have to recognize that change happens at the speed of trust. That's as fast as we can go. People have to buy into what you're doing. They have to believe in what you're doing. They have to come along with the ideas. And this idea of building a culture of health is something that, it's a new idea. It was a new idea of thinking, how do we bring new voices into it? And how do we bring communities that weren't necessarily at the table into the conversation? And to do that, you really have to think about how do you build trust and leverage trust? And as you use this metaphor of thinking around sitting around the table, how do we, as we sit around the table, get each of us, as we're sitting there, to trust the people next to us? And so a lot of times what happens in philanthropy is, the downside is that philanthropy picks winners and losers, right? That's what grant makers do a lot. They go into a community and they have this funding idea, right? And of course, healthcare systems and community-based nonprofits, they're going to respond to philanthropy when they come in, or grant makers when they come in, because they want grants, right? So if the philanthropy says, we are going to fund around opioid addiction, or we're going to fund around decreasing teenage pregnancy, or we're going to fund around increasing access to prenatal care, then that's what most community-based nonprofits are going to try to focus on. And what can happen in a community is there can be, and we know it did happen and has happened, what can happen is that there is a mission creep, right? So philanthropy comes in and puts resources on the table and says, we want you to focus on this area. This organization that may have been working and doing great work around, let's say they're doing great work around the nurse family partnership, or doing great work around housing, or doing great work around getting kids to graduate from high school. They may change their aims and their mission to get that funding, right? And so they kind of stretch themselves like, well, we could make a tweak here and tweak there, and we had to get that funding. And what happens when that is that that organization, which was doing great work, has stretched itself, right? And become weaker, and which is goes completely the opposite of what we want to happen in communities. We don't want communities to get weaker. We want them to get stronger. But when we kind of put resources on the table sometimes, we get them to stretch themselves. What also happens is that they compete against other organizations, right? And so Community X is competing against Community Y to get these resources that philanthropy has brought into the community. And that's not great. And so there has to be this trust, not just within the community, but within philanthropy, trusting that if we trust the communities to work together and be able to tell us what they need and get them to understand that, hey, you know, we're not going to fund one-off community-based nonprofits anymore just to do work alone. We really need to be working together, that there's something that good things can happen. And so as community members start to sit around, 1 second, RJ, stop. As we get communities to sit together and start to trust each other and stop competing against each other, they find ways to share their assets. They find ways to start to think about how they can leverage what exists, these assets already exist in the community, and share them in many ways. And so the trust happens both ways. Again, as we move upstream, we really have to focus on population health, thinking about, instead of just thinking about the individual, thinking about the whole population that's affected. And that is a paradigm shift. That's something that is a new way of going into thinking about communities. And it's something that I think as we'll talk about later, or I'll discuss later in this conversation, is really thinking about what happened within the pandemic. We realize that, yeah, it requires a whole thinking about the whole population as we address these challenges that are happening in communities. RJ, don't turn that on. So again, thinking about as we're moving upstream, what are we really trying to do? And as we think about health equity. Health equity is all about opportunity, right? The opportunity to be healthy. It is not it's never really going to work when we come into a community and tell them that they have to eat this, or they have to exercise this much, or that they have to necessarily get this immunization. We see that all the time, that there's a lot of resistance to that. But what we do want to be able to do is create opportunities for these fair and just opportunities for everyone to have the healthiest life possible, and allow people to choose what they want to do. And it's never going to be one thing. It's not like we're just going to change the diet opportunities or change activity opportunities. It's a whole range of different mechanisms that have to occur. And again, it's easier to think about what we do upstream, how it impacts what happens downstream. RJ, shut that off. Shut it off. So again, as you think about how we address these upstream challenges, we realize that there are different conversations that we're having, that we have to think about health differently, that we have to start thinking about these upstream and social determinants of health, these root causes of what influences our health. And those are things like employment and transportation and high school graduation and third grade reading proficiency, access to parks and playgrounds, access to safe, affordable housing. I mean, these are all health conversations, and they're not necessarily conversations that we were having before, right? I mean, we're always going to have to deal with what happens downstream. We're always going to deal with hypertension and type 1 and type 2 diabetes and deal with different kinds of other chronic illnesses. But how do we kind of bring these other conversations in there? And that's really at the heart of what we're trying to do in our grant making at New Jersey Health Initiative, was really thinking about how do we, one, move the conversation upstream, engage new voices in the conversation, and really figure out ways to bring more people to the table, and really have them start to put their heads together, start to trust each other. And it was hard in the beginning. When we first started doing our grant making, there was a lot of ideas of, well, we want to have a health fair. I mean, that was something that we heard a lot in a lot of communities. They want to have a health fair, or they want to have a farmer's market. And there's nothing necessarily bad about a farmer's market. A health fair is a little bit challenging because there's limits to what we can do when we tell somebody they have hypertension and then we just let them go away. Like if we do a blood screen and find that they see what their blood sugar is. So we really tried to shift these ideas and really get communities to start thinking about what are the opportunities, what does it mean to think about the social determinants of health or the root causes of health? What does it mean to get people to come to the table and be part of the conversation? When we say people, we mean elected officials, and we'll talk some about that. And we mean school nurses and school superintendents and all these others that we need. But at the kind of center of that is this really idea of thinking about how do we get this kind of hyper local focus, which is a shift, right? Which is a shift in understanding that every community has a different need, and what we historically have done in philanthropy is come in and say, well, we want you to focus on this area, and that might be great for Patterson, but not so great for Perth Amboy. Or it might work in Camden, but not work so well in Atlantic City or Bridgeton. But what really we've tried to do in our grant making is saying, hey, we don't know your community as well as you do. All we can do really well is try to get as many different people at the table and tell you what we think that you can be thinking about in terms of the bigger root causes, but tell us what your root causes are. And so in our grant making has changed in that way, because we have really tried to be a partner more as opposed to being a grant funder, be a partner with communities and allowing them to tell us what they need. And great things happen when we've done that. And so as Miriam mentioned, I started my career as a nurse in a non-traditional kind of way. For those of you that are nurses, I'm hoping we have a few nurses in the audience. The first thing that nurses usually do after they get a nursing school is to go work in med-surg. And I was a second degree nurse, and I knew I went into nursing because I wanted to work with young people. I wanted to be in the community. And so my first job out of nursing school, I went to the Board of Ed in the city of Camden. And I applied for a job as a school nurse. And it was something that was, I didn't know if I was going to get it, but I went in there and I met with a woman named Marilyn Mell, and she passed away a couple of years ago, but she was the health advisor, the health supervisor for the city of Camden. So she did all the hiring. She'd been in the role for a long time. And she brought me into her office and she sized me up. We talked a little bit and I told her why I wanted to be a school nurse, and she said, "Look, I think I was 26 or 27 at the time," and she said, "I've never hired a man before as a school nurse. As most of you know, there's not a lot of men in school nursing, and I've never hired somebody fresh out of nursing school. I've never hired somebody without a nursing certification, school nurse certification. But I'm going to hire you, and I'm going to put you in a middle school in Camden." East Camden Middle School. You're going to have 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th graders, and I think you're going to be fine. And she gave me great advice. She told me there's going to be, as most of you know that have kids, the school nurses do a lot of they do a lot of screenings, right, for scoliosis and hearing and vision. And she said, yeah, you're going to have all your screenings. You're going to have all your first dates. You're going to have all those things. But remember to go in every day and have fun and just enjoy the experience. And that was the best advice I think I've ever had in any work that I've done, is to go in there, because that's what I did. And every day I was able to go into the school, which was in the city of Camden. I grew up in Cherry Hill, which is in South Jersey, which is only a few minute drive in terms of the distance from Camden. But obviously there's a big difference in the socioeconomics of the two communities. Cherry Hill is a pretty suburban, affluent community, and Camden has a lot of socioeconomic challenges. And I was still living at the time at my parents' house, so I'd drive out every day. And I'd see all this kind of these differences between these two communities. But the kids were the same, right? The kids in Camden were a lot like the kids that I grew up with in Cherry Hill in terms of the things they wanted for their lives, the things that they wanted to hope for. They had big dreams, and they were, they were funny, and they were really smart. And I learned something every day in that job. And one of the great things about that job is, you know, if I was younger and I had the same kind of stereotypical ideas about the city of Camden that a lot of people do. I mean, that's a dangerous place. And one thing that would happen in my job is that adolescent girls would come to my office, and they would come in a group, right? And they would kind of create a circle in my office and sit around and talk. And I'd just kind of sit on the outside and get to listen and learn all about who the cute teachers were, who the cute guys were, and the things that they were thinking about. And I learned a lot about adolescent females from that work. And that was really kind of eye-opening. But the boys were different. Like, the boys in the hallway would look really tough, or they'd have their hoods on, and they would, you know, give me a tough guy nod walking down the hallway. But they would come to my office too, and they would come in, but they would only come in, you know, by themselves. Just one boy would come in at a time, and they'd come in and they'd close the door, and they take off their hood, and then they would just start talking, you know, and they just start telling me all these things about their life and everything that they were dealing with. And it was felt like this real privilege to be able to hear about their lives and make that connection with them. And so as a grant maker, one of the first things I did was try to figure out how are we going to bring in school nurses, because I knew the school nurses had this really important perspective. And one of the things that we funded in the past few years has been this school nurses and the weekend backpack program. And we funded school nurses to do, which is basically surveillance, because school nurses have all the special information, what's happening in their school community. They know what's happening in the outside community. So the weekend backpack programs, the way they work is kids who are living in households that are food insecure are given a backpack every Friday when they leave, and that backpack has non-perishable foods in it, not just enough for the kid, but enough for the whole family. And they send those home, and it comes back on Monday, and then next Friday they get filled up again with food. And it's a great idea, and it's something that really makes a lot of sense, because school nurses have this hyper-local knowledge, and nurses have this hyper-local knowledge, and so it's something that allows us to address food security, but also allows us to think about, you know, what are the bigger issues around food access. And one of the issues that, if we get a chance to talk about at the end with the pandemic, is that we saw the food systems, you know, for a lot of kids, they get two meals a day at school. So the weekend is the hungriest time of the week, and the summer is the hungriest time of the year. And that's something that we've learned through school nurses and some other programs that we've funded. But that's something we learned from the community. Again, we've also learned from school superintendents and how we bring them to the conversation, how we bring school superintendents to the health conversation. So we funded a couple school superintendents across the state to really implement mental health first aid programs. And mental health first aid is almost like CPR. you know, you teach lay people how to identify mental health red flags. They're not going to obviously treat it, but to have them be able to screen for it, understand it, is important. It's important for two reasons. One, it's great to have people have that kind of information. The other thing, it's great that they are able to drive a conversation, right? So when you get mayors and school superintendents and police chiefs thinking about mental health first aid, it's a great thing. And it really kind of helps that conversation, helps us think upstream. We've also funded police chiefs around adverse childhood experiences. In this picture, there's two pictures here. One is a police chief at the top. He is third from the left. His name is Chris Luzner, and he's a really dynamic, thoughtful police chief down in Cape May. And he came to us because he was part of a coalition in Cape May that we funded that was really trying to do work around adverse childhood experiences. And we had this police chief, John Shaw, in Riverton, who went in and spent a day with a school nurse and really understood kind of what's happening within the schools. And so this back and forth with the police chiefs and making them part of the conversation and law enforcement part of the conversation. It's just something, again, that's how we move upstream. So how do we sustain this work? You know, one of the big things to do to sustain this work is really think about an asset-based approach. Thinking about what does a community have? Not necessarily kind of what they don't have, because every community has things that they are challenged to provide for their citizens. But every community also has some assets. So this picture is from the city of Bridgeton. And that man there in the bow tie is Mayor Al Kelly. He's been the mayor for a while. And he came to us a few years ago with an idea that he wanted to address food insecurity in his community. He knew a lot of kids were hungry, a lot of families were hungry, and he knew that the United States Department of Agriculture had a program that was undersubscribed. Right? They had a summer feeding program that people weren't applying to. And like I mentioned earlier, summer is the hungriest time of the year for a lot of kids in distressed communities. And he wanted to see more of children and families in his community enrolling in the program so they get meals over the summer. And so we had some ideas around engaging youth and how we might use youth to go door to door to see who wasn't enrolled. And we were able to fund a program in his community that became a model for a $3 million funding initiative that we ran in 2017. And the youth in this picture were all hired and trained and paid as their summer job to go door to door in the city of Bridgeton and get families enrolled in the summer feeding program. And they enrolled hundreds of families. And they did something that was not just good for the children that were getting fed, but for the parents that didn't have to worry about how they're going to find the funds and find the money to feed their kids in the summertime. And so that's something that, that's something that when we work with the community as a partner, not doing to them, but working with them, we kind of get these great ideas and it's been something that's been one of the real fun parts of my job as a grant maker is to really think about how do we ask the community and trust the community to, again, come to us and tell a lot of them what their community needs. Again, another piece, and these dots on this map of New Jersey really represent all the cross-sector coalitions that we're funding across the state. And you can see as far north as Patterson and down to Cape May, we have these cross-sector coalitions. And they are coalitions that have those individuals that I talked to you about, that I mentioned earlier. They have police chiefs and school superintendents and school principals and residents and young people and older adults all sitting around tables. And that's kind of the requirement of our grant making is if we are going to give you funding, you really have to tell us not necessarily what you're going to do, but who are you going to do it with? Who are you going to bring into the conversation? How are you going to keep them there? And our communities have thought all range of different innovative ideas for how that they engage people in their communities and things that they decide to address, whether it be combined sewer overflow or transportation challenges for their older adults, like bringing a thing called a go-go grandma into their community that they did in Asbury Park. We've had programs addressing lead and programs addressing housing and how we get people make sure that they have adequate housing. And so all these ideas, again, are something that come out of these cross-sector coalitions, right? The more people we get to the table, the more diversity of ideas that we get, and the better we're able to think about what the community really needs. And again, I mean, a part of that is also the community starts to develop these muscles of working together, right? They start, as they start to trust each other, this is an issue that creates opportunities because the pie gets bigger, right? As people start to share assets, and they trust each other and they're sitting around the table, and they're really kind of working not for the benefit of their individual organization, but for the benefit of the community gets stronger. So it's been something really exciting. It's thinking about how to bring these cross-sector coalitions together. The other thing is that we've really thought about is we have to change policies and systems. That's how we sustain our work, is not through providing a $200,000 grant or a $300,000 grant. That money goes pretty quickly. But if we can change policies and systems at the local level or at the state level, then we can really make a difference. And this is something that happened for us early in the year. Governor Murphy saw some of the work we were doing around mental health first aid, work that others were doing around mental health first aid, and really decided to lean into thinking about initiatives that engage more youth in mental health first aid. And the mental health first aid that he's really trying to focus on, it's something that we were also able to start in the state, is to train youth to become mental health first aid certified so they could recognize their peers that were having mental health first aid struggles, mental health struggles. And so it's something that, you know, really is at the center of what we're thinking about, is how do we engage new voices, bring assets in, change policies and systems, really work across sectors, really work across boundaries. For us, is at the center of the work we're trying to do around building a culture of health and really trying to address health equity. So I mentioned that there are kind of three big ideas or three acts, I think I said that I would think about or talk about that it really get at this idea of creating opportunity and health equity, you know, as I envision this talk. And one of those really came out of some work that I'd done when I was a school nurse in the city of Camden. As I mentioned, at the end of every day, I would drive out of the city of Camden, and I was struck by the number of kids a lot of kids from my school were just kind of hanging out after school. They weren't really going anywhere. They weren't going to a Little League program. They weren't going to CCD. They weren't going to take piano lessons. They were just kind of standing around. They weren't doing anything wrong, but they're just kind of hanging out. And I played soccer all through my life, and I played college soccer. And I asked a couple of the kids that I knew from my school. I said, what do you think about, meet me at the park? There's a park really close to where I was. I said, why don't you meet after school and we'll play some soccer? And it started this kind of after school thing started with 10 kids. And within a month, I had 50 kids that were coming after school to play soccer. And so I was like 27 years old, and I had a whistle and some cones and some soccer balls, and I had all these kids, and they were coming, and it was fun, but it was also a little bit overwhelming. So I reached out to this guy named Dan Hart. He was a professor at at Rutgers in Camden. This was back in 1995. And I said, hell, I have these kids coming after school, and I'd like to study and collect some data on these kids so I can apply for a grant. You know, kind of funny, you know, 25 years ago, I'm trying to get a grant. And he said, oh, yeah, yeah, it sounds interesting. I could help you figure out something around that. And but I also like to help you with it. And so this guy, Dan Hart, he's a psychology professor, knew a lot about civic development, moral development. He came out and we started to develop this program, which we ended up calling the Camden Star Program, Sports Teaching Adolescents Response Building Resilience. And it was started out as a soccer program, but we added community service to it. And then every year we started to take 40 to 50 kids up to East Burke, Vermont. We rented out what's called the Burke Mountain Ski Academy for a week every summer. And we would have the kids, we'd do camping, we'd play soccer, the kids would make meals. It was really kind of this really fun group experience, but also something allowed us to really understand the challenges that the young people are dealing with. And also gave us some ideas about how we could start to really use and work with youth as partners in making their community healthier. So we start, like I said, we did community service projects like Thanksgiving basket drives and tree plantings and a bunch of different things we would do. And the youth love doing it, and it's great for the community. And so that gave us some initial ideas. That was like 25 years ago. So I told you that we did a youth engagement project through New Jersey Health Initiatives. But the idea started then of thinking about how can we work with youth and also give us some ideas around thinking about the value of youth groups, like how do youth groups create opportunities. So growing up, like I said, I played soccer and I was part of great things in school that were after school and all these kind of co-curricular things that happened. But that was all around kind of thinking about the idea of being in good groups, like what good groups do for youth. And there's not enough of those opportunities in places like Camden and Patterson and Bridgeton and Salem, Atlantic City, Willingboro, all these places across the state. One thing that really distinguished those communities is that they don't have enough youth groups, and youth groups create opportunities because when youth join a group, yeah, they get to do something fun, but they also connect to these non-parental adults that can make a really big difference in their lives. And so that was one of the reasons why I wanted to do that poll, was to ask, you know, who was volunteering. I see a lot of people that looked like at least a quarter of respondents in the poll are working with a youth group. And then that's something that we think is really important. So Dan Hart, who I, you know, became my best friend, he's the godfather of one of my sons, and just been a great, important person in my life. We started doing a lot of work together around not just running the STAR program that we ran for 20 years, but as researchers. And so we're actually working on a book right now, really looking at youth groups and thinking about how do we use youth groups to create opportunities for youth. And youth groups are something that, as I pointed out, there's fewer of them right now, but there's fewer voluntary associations in general. I mean, our country used to be a country of joiners, right? We used to, back in the 30s and 40s and 20s, Alex de Tocqueville, like one of the things that he really recognized about our country, like he's, you know, somebody who came and looked and did some really important studies of you know, early United States, he said, this is the country of joiners. These people join organizations. And through those organizations, they learn about democracy. They become better citizens. And in here, I have a, you know, there's Rotary clubs and Masons clubs and Elks clubs and all these clubs and things that people joined. But this is, in this picture right here, I love it because my granddad was in this rod and gun club. There were thousands upon thousands of different kind of clubs that people joined. And they learned to, some of them were religious, some of them were fraternal, some were civic, but they connected people to communities. They were important. And they connected people to each other, right? And so, right, people learned to, how do you run an organization? We need a treasurer, we need a secretary. So people were able to take important roles in those. And they developed citizenship skills for those things. But they also connected people to communities, right? They created these networks and social capital and the civic muscle and gave people this opportunity to figure out how to all pull in the same direction, right? That's what our country was about in the early 1900s. And then in the 1960s, we started to change. Fewer people started to join groups. Groups that used to be there became very professional, and they had front offices, and people weren't necessarily joining groups. They were maybe writing a check for the American Red Cross or the Sierra Club, but they weren't joining groups anymore. And a couple different historians, they had a Scotch Pull, and Robert Putnam wrote books about this, one of them called Bowling Alone, you might have heard of. And it really looked at this this decrease in social capital, right? Social capital is really this network of connections that you have in a community, but also the social trust a community has, right? How people feel connected to each other. And as we stopped joining groups, we felt less connected to each other. We had this kind of crisis of connectedness. And this is something that that we're kind of dealing with right now. I think we might talk a little, you know, we don't have to be very political about it, but I think that as you look at the results from the election we just had, we are a very divided nation right now. We have a very red and very blue country right now. We have to find some way to bring that back together. So at a really 30,000 foot level, we need to find ways to have more groups, youth groups and all sorts of voluntary associations. But for communities like Camden and Trenton and Newark and Irvington, and Jersey City and Patterson, we also know that youth groups create opportunities for young people in those communities, and we need more of those. And one of the reasons we don't have those, some of the things we've found from our research, is that it has to do with child density. And so Camden is a much more child-dense place than Cherry Hill, right? And so I talked about Cherry Hill, that's where I grew up. So Cherry Hill has about 25% of the population is under the age of 18 in Cherry Hill. In Camden, 33, depending on what community it is, sometimes 40% of the population is under the age of 18, right? So that changes the age structure, right? And so you can look at these two slides that I have right here. The blue dots represent young people under the age of 18. The red dots represent adults, right? And you can see that in Camden, it's about two adults for every one child. And Cherry Hill is about three adults for every one child or person under the age of 18. And that might not seem like a big difference, like two versus one, but that's a huge difference in terms of how we can create opportunities. Again, go back to this idea of opportunities. How do we create opportunities in communities? Adults create opportunities for young people. One, by doing kind of like what I did in Camden, right? We create youth groups. Adults are the ones that run little leagues, right? For the quarter of you that run teams and clubs, those are from adults, right? Adults are there to rough the games and get kids signed up and do all those kinds of things, coach the teams. But all the adults also have assets, right? They have networks. They can teach kids about things non-parental adults know things about life that kids' peers don't have. And so you can see in these slides, especially in Camden, kids are going to spend more time with kids in Camden than they're going to do in Cherry Hill because there's fewer adults to spend time with. Right? So again, it matters in terms of who influences young people in places like Camden and Cherry Hill. And so our country used to be much more youthful. We used to be not necessarily like Camden, but we used to the proportion used to be closer to Camden than to Cherry Hill. But our most distressed communities, not just in New Jersey, but across the nation, look more like Camden. They have fewer adults, they have more kids, they're child dense, they're youthful. And that can be a great thing if you're able to provide resources and kind of structure. But if you aren't, then kids just end up hanging out with kids, and that's not always great. And so these pictures are from the youth group that Dan and I ran in Camden. This is a tree planting we did. That was one of the community service projects. And you can see on the back row, that's Dan in the white t-shirt, looking a little bit suspicious at the guys to his right. And those guys weren't part of our program, two of those kids. They just saw what their pictures were being taken, so they just came and got in the picture. So it's kind of a funny story. But the other slide is a field trip we went on with the kids to some swim park. And it was just an opportunity to kind of get the kids out of Camden. So anyway, yeah, good groups connect youth to adults and communities, and they're important. Act two. The other thing that we have really kind of figured out through our grant making is that as much as we're invested in equity and this idea of opportunity, we're not always doing the best job of it. We know that from looking at our data that we don't always make grants to the communities that have the greatest need. And so we did some analysis. I won't really go into the analysis. I have a paper that's coming out next year in Stanford Social Innovation Review, but it does analysis of our funding data. And what we basically find is that a lot of the communities that are of greatest need, communities that have the most distress, aren't getting our funding because they're either not applying for our funding, or they apply and they are not, their applications aren't as competitive as those that are from communities that have a lot of challenges but have more assets, right? So a metropolitan community like Trenton or Newark or Jersey City or Elizabeth, they have distress, they have challenges, but they have a lot of assets too. They have a lot of human capital assets. They have people who know how to write really good grants. They have community-based organizations that know how to analyze data. They know, so when they give a funding application, it looks really strong. And a lot of times grant makers end up giving them the funding. So there's a hidden bias in what we do in our grant making. So what we really need to be doing, and we're really trying to do in our grant making, is thinking about how do we kind of address this equity issue by being more intentional. And maybe we can talk about that. We have a couple of minutes to talk about that. But this is a map of New Jersey, and you can kind of show those communities that are the most distressed. They're in that darker red. And you can see, yeah, there's a lot of those communities up there. But there's also distressed communities that are more urban, and then we'll call those Newarks. And so you can see light red colored communities are the places that get a lot of our funding. So just focus on the dark red and the light red, but those are places that get a lot of our funding. But the other places have the same amount of distress, they just get less of our funding. And the last thing I wanted to talk about before I kind of get to some questions is really just what we learned about equity and through the pandemic and the Black Lives Matter protest. And in a nutshell, what we basically found out is something that we should have kind of known is that, when something like a pandemic hits, the places that are going to get hardest are the places that have the least amount of resources, the places of greatest need. That's where it's going to hit the hardest. And so when we look at the communities in Jersey that really got slammed by the pandemic, there are places that are, kind of flying underneath our radar. Going back to what I just talked about, these communities of greatest need, they are the communities of greatest need because they are not only less likely to have a lot of the assets that help communities withstand economic downturns and pandemics and Superstorm Sandy's, But they're also less likely to be able to apply successfully for the grant funding, right? So there was a New Jersey Pandemic Relief Fund that gave out, you know, $30+ million, but the communities of greatest need didn't necessarily get those dollars because they didn't apply for them. By the time they got their act together to apply for them, the funds were already gone. I think this slide basically says it all. But as you can imagine, the Pandemic Relief Fund exposed these kinds of challenges that these communities had, and then a lot of those communities were challenged to address food insecurity, learning loss within their schools, right? Because as all of you that have kids that are home right now, I have a couple of kids in the house right now that are studying virtually. That's not happening in our communities and a lot of our most distressed communities. Those kids don't have the broadband access. They don't have the laptop, they don't have the kinds of things that they need. So a lot of those challenges are hitting them. And a lot of the issues around health access were also exposed by the pandemic. Maybe we can talk about that. But I think I will turn it back over. And hopefully we have some time for some questions. So I'm going to turn this back to Miriam.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you so much. That was really enlightening. And we have quite a few questions.
Okay. All right, let's get to it.
Okay, somebody asked, as a healthcare provider, how can I make and encourage community coalitions? Also, if you're outside of New Jersey, do you have suggestions of where to find funding for community coalitions? So if you could please talk about how to encourage community coalitions and funding outside of Jersey.
Yeah. I think that's what a lot of these community coalitions, one of the reasons I was excited to be able to have this conversation is that the community coalitions that we are funding benefit when they have people who have a health background at the table, being part of the conversation. And we are really trying to find ways to bring in, obviously not just nurses, but all other kinds of people who understand how to use data, who understand some of what the health challenges are, who are really invested and interested in thinking about how to be part of those conversations. And so it's something that that we're not just doing in New Jersey. A growing number of funders are doing that as well, thinking about how to how to work with these cross-sector coalitions. And so I guess part of what I would suggest is that if you think about where you can do the most good, you know, it might not be in your community. It might be in the community that's adjacent to you or near you. It may be in a community that you don't necessarily live in, but you know of and you could connect to. And I would really try to encourage others to think about, are there ways that they can take some of their resources and get into these communities of greatest need? And it may be a more rural community, it may be a more urban community, but are there ways that you can give some of your expertise, some of your time, talent, energy to these places that are that have less, fewer resources. And just to make another hit for the youth group idea, same thing with those of you that are that are thinking about how you can volunteer. I mean, you could go help these youth groups in places like Camden, because that's a lot of times where you can do the greatest good.
And how do you build, you said that there are so many different organizations, and how does one build those coalitions with different organizations, in order to encourage, you know, so you don't want to be redundant in terms of the services, but you also want to, you know, build capacity and help, supplement each other.
Yeah, no, I think that is the thing there, is how do we not be redundant? How do we're really encouraging communities to figure out ways to work together. And then one of the things I didn't mention, our grant making, a lot of things we stipulate in our grant making, and a lot of funders do the same thing, is we're only going to give one grant to this community. And it actually looks, it doesn't look as good if we get more than one application from a community, because we're saying, look, we have to have cross-sector coalitions. So why are there two or three cross-sector coalitions? I won't name the community, but in one, we do annual funding initiatives where we, we fund grants between, $100,000 and $300,000. We'll give out, 10 or 12 or 15 of them. And we try to give them across the state, but we make it very clear that we're not going to give multiple ones in one community. And so we've had instances where we get, five, six applications from cross-sector coalitions that are all in the same community. And it's something that we are really trying to make clear that, hey, that's not really signaling that you are finding ways to work across sectors, that if you are getting, we're getting all this many different applications. Does that make sense?
Definitely. Definitely. And what are some of the, what suggestions do you have for finding funding outside of New Jersey?
I think that I know less about philanthropy in Pennsylvania. A lot of what we know from some of our analyses, a lot of the funding resides in, they basically have a saying of, you basically fund where you stand. So if a lot of the funders are in more metropolitan areas and there's less funding in the rural areas. And so it's harder for individuals that live further from the city centers to get funding because there are fewer funders out there. But my suggestion would be, as you think about, how you can do the most good, is to, as I said, I started a nonprofit, but that's something that we probably don't need more nonprofits. We have a lot of nonprofits across New Jersey and across other states. We have probably way too many nonprofits. And so how do you take the resources you have and join an existing nonprofit? Like, even if you have a great idea, but you don't have to start a nonprofit. You might be able to just find a nonprofit that and volunteer and give your time and bring your ideas there.
Well, that's great, because one of the questions was also about a provider, a healthcare provider, who wanted to work or in the community and also wanted to have the community connections and help their community as a healthcare provider. To strengthen their community. So you just pretty much answered that question. They don't have to, start a nonprofit. They can join forces with some nonprofits that are already existent in their communities.
Yeah, and Miriam, to that point, is that sometimes, it's not necessarily, they have skills as a healthcare provider, but again, there's skills that community-based nonprofits need in terms of being able to write good grants or being able to look at data or being able to find where the grant opportunities are. So there's so many skills that I think we take for granted as healthcare providers that are valuable to communities because you think, well, what could I do? Well, yeah, maybe they don't need you to be to use your skills as a pediatrician or a speech language pathologist, but there's other things that you know from your training that could be of value. And I think all of those tools and assets you bring are super great value to community-based nonprofits that are always looking to, they're always in need of individuals that have expertise.
Someone asked, what advice do you have to recruit more minorities and underserved communities into research studies? And as an addendum to that, is Robert Wood Johnson involved in getting more minorities in research or funding any such proposals?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So the foundation has four big buckets of areas that they fund in. One is healthy communities. One is healthy children and families. Another is basically looking at kind of healthcare systems, aligning healthcare systems, that kind of piece. And the fourth is leadership. And I think that question really kind of looks at that leadership category. The foundation is trying to develop leaders. I mean, I think as we think about what does it take to create opportunities, what it takes to build healthier communities, we have to develop leaders and invest in leaders who are, some are early leaders, some are you know, mid-career leaders, but giving training. The foundation puts a lot of emphasis on that. And I think, you know, when we thought of our what we call the Next Generation Community Leaders Program that I mentioned in the talk, that was a leadership program, right? We're trying to build better citizens, but also build better leaders. And so part of that is kind of what I think the questioner asked about is, you know, was how do we teach or support people in being able to look at data, to look at data and kind of make sense of it and be able to tell the story of this is what's happening in my community. And that doesn't mean that they have to go and collect data. There's so much data that we have that they can access. And so we've put funding into initiatives that support grassroots people in being able to look at different data and make use of it to think about the challenges that are present in their communities. And I hope that answered that question. But I'd be happy to send you a description of one of our most recent funding initiatives that really kind of looks at that using data and research to help communities think clearly about what their challenges are.
Thank you. So someone asked, we offer free developmental screening, but how do we find potential funders to keep it going?
Yeah, I mean, that's a hard one. In terms of how do you continue to fund that, especially when you know from my talk that there is, when you look at the Robert Johnson Foundation or you look at New Jersey Health Initiatives, like we get requests like, oh, will you fund like the screening program? And the screening program can be great, but it's not something that is really aligns with what we're funding right now. I mean, you know, it might be something 15 years ago or 10 years ago, but screening programs are something that they're important, but it's harder to find funders for those kinds of initiatives because they, you know, funders have a limited amount of resources and they are really trying to stick to their strategic goals. But with that being said, I think that there are opportunities to think about how do you leverage other assets to find ways to fund those kinds of programs, you know, and whether there could be things that are happening with schools and school systems. I mean, there's some really dynamic and innovative school superintendents that sometimes are able to find funds to support that, especially if somebody's able to help them write grants through that. There's a lot of funding out there that goes underutilized. A lot of dollars go back because people don't apply for it, because people don't know that they can apply for it. And that can be in spaces of education, transportation. We told you about what happened with the summer feeding program. I mean, those were millions and millions of dollars that the USDA was putting out that weren't being used because people didn't know how to apply for the funding. So my suggestion on developmental screening would be to find out, is there a way that you can find an existing funding source? And it would probably have to be a state or federal one. It wouldn't be a private philanthropy like the Robert Johnson Foundation that would be able to fund that activity under their under an existing funding stream. Because I guarantee you, for every funding stream, there's dollars that go back to state and federal government because people don't apply for the dollars.
And to that point, you mentioned earlier that there are smaller organizations that do not apply for grants or do not receive grants because their proposals are not competitive. What can be done about that? How do you support those organizations that are doing very important work, but don't have the capacity, don't know grantsmanship, so they don't even know when these grants are available, or when grants are available to them, or how to write a successful proposal?
Yeah, no, and I think that's a great point, Mary, is that there's two issues with that. One is that we should be coaching and providing support for those communities, right? If we want them to, if we know that the only way you get fed is by getting to the table, and we know that these smaller organizations with less capacity aren't getting to the table, then we have to provide coaching, right? And so we've done this in our grant making, is provide coaching to say, look, you don't have to write a full funding proposal. Write a brief funding proposal. Tell us what your idea is. Like, that doesn't take a lot of time, right? And we can have, you give us a one pager, and from that we can develop a full proposal. We'll give you coaching. So we put funding into thinking about how to support that. The other thing we've done is try to think about, that kind of falls on grant makers, is we have to be intentional about who we select to who's eligible to apply for a grant, right? If we know that Newark and Trenton and Atlantic City have a lot of capacity, we shouldn't have them competing against Bridgeton and Salem and Willingboro and Irvington. So some of it falls on the funding side. Some of it falls on, like, what can we do to kind of support that to create the opportunity? And some of it falls on how do we as grant makers shape the opportunity so we get the right people at the table. If we know we're trying to catch, because we have this, like, basement first floor problem where we definitely have communities that are in the basement and we're not thinking about them. And those are the first floor, that's what we're focused on. So I hope that answers your question, but that's a really important point and something that I think we have to work at from a couple different angles.
And actually, to follow up on that, somebody asked, if grants come in from the same community, is there any communication between grant providers and applicants to facilitate cross-sector coalition collaboration?
Yes, I mean, sometimes that is something that we try to do. Is if we, like, say we get something from, I'll just pick a name out of hat, Trenton, and Trenton has a lot of community-based nonprofits, and we get a funding application from two different cross-sector coalitions, and we might say, hey, you know what, or we know that they're going to apply, and we tell them, look, you are actually reducing your chances of getting this funding award for Trenton because you should be at the same table. Why do we have these different cross-sector coalitions that are all representing the same community, Trenton or New Brunswick or Newark? Why aren't you sitting at the same table? And so sometimes we do outreach in advance and say, you know what, you should talk to this other cross-sector coalition and apply with them as opposed to you putting in your own application. But, you know, a lot of funders don't do that, but it's something that I think we have to be more intentional about.
I see. Somebody asked, how can we encourage community engagement in the time of COVID? And I know that you said that many of the grants are based on, well, all of the grants are based on the foundation's strategic planning. But what has COVID done to much of that planning? And are there emergency grants, or how are foundations changing the way they do business in order to account for COVID and the coronavirus and how it's affecting communities?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So the Robert Johnson Foundation, when the pandemic hit, one of the things that they did with New Jersey Health Initiatives, right, with the statewide grant making, and they did with all, and the foundation did with all their grantees, is they said to existing grantees, if you have our dollars and you are doing Project X, COVID hit and you need to address housing instability because people don't money for rent or food access or whatever issue you're dealing with, use our dollars for that. So you can take the existing dollars and use it for that. Another thing that they did was to give New Jersey Health Initiatives, they gave us more funds, like $500,000, just to fund places that we said are likely to fall through the cracks. And so we ended up funding, we knew agricultural workers down in the southern part of the state weren't going to be necessarily getting the personal protective equipment or the kind of education. So we gave a big grant to a group to work with them. We gave a grant up in Morris County that worked with undocumented individuals and families that were had issues around food access. We gave a grant for in Newark for those that were working with older adults. So we tried to find, for us, we really tried to focus on putting that money we had to focus on groups that were going to fall through the cracks, that were never going to be able to apply for funding and that we weren't thinking about. So so I really think the foundation showed up in a great way around that in terms of giving existing communities that had the funds to kind of use them to flex how they're using them and gave us additional funding to think about those who are falling through the cracks. And we also gave out smaller grants to existing, to other organizations to do different work around, again, most of it was around food access, learning loss, housing instability. Those are the kind of big things that were exposed as inequities during the pandemic.
Okay. Now, to bring it back to your work with STAR in Camden, based on your research, have you measured health or healthcare impact with your the STAR program and other work you've done with youth in Camden?
Yeah, we've never done that much. We've done some. I've gotten some funding to do that work, and a lot of what we, as those of you that work with youth know, it takes a while to figure out the impact of what you've done, and it is something that even when you do a really great job, it's probably only going to be incremental. Not that that doesn't matter, but a lot of what we did in our work was take kids who are kind of could go either way, right? They could, you know, kind of not get on a path to healthy, constructive adulthood or kind of go on something where they got into some activities that weren't going to contribute to their health. So dropping out of high school or, you know, maybe premature parenthood or all these kinds of things that we don't want. So a lot of what we know is probably less empirical, more anecdotal in terms of the kids in our program. And what they're able to achieve and the kind of how we improved our life chances. A lot of that's what we looked at. And that's what we really kind of were thinking about in terms of, you know, what we're able to do for these kids. But it's hard because as much as I think youth groups are important, we're writing a book about it, we realize that there's limitations to what they're going to do. I mean, just like there's limitations to what a school is going to do, right? A school has a kid, gets a child, sometimes at the age of 4 or 5, they have them for 180 days a year for 6 hours a day. There's a limit to how much the school is going to have an impact on their life chances. There's other things that are happening within their family structure, within their communities, within society writ large that are going to impact that. So I think we have to be really realistic about the impact that we can have. As much as I think good youth groups are important, I also acknowledge that there's limits to what they're actually going to be able to do. But that's not saying they're not important, because they can make that a huge difference for that child who you're able to help get into college or help to get that first job or get that internship or fill out the financial aid forms, all the things that I'm sure a lot of people in the audience, the skills that they have, they'd be of great value to youth who are living in distressed communities that would benefit from having that opportunity to connect with those people.
And how do you get engaged with the parents of the youth involved in your various programs? And tell us a little more about how, or, you know, what is their, what are their attitudes, or what are some challenges or successes? How do you engage the parents of those
youth? Yeah, Miriam, that's a great question. So that was one of the things that was two kinds of realizations that I made as I started working in the city of Camden was first that parents in Camden and places like Camden love their kids as much as my parents love me, as much as I love my son. They care as much, right? And that doesn't mean they have the same resources, right? And they don't have the same opportunities to improve the life chances. As parents, what we basically do is take the flaws and mediocrity of our kids and optimize it to give them the best possible outcomes we can. And a lot of times parents that are in lower income communities, they want the best for their kids. They don't have the same resources to work with. And so that's really the big difference between affluent parents and less affluent parents is the resources they have to take their kids. Let's face it, most kids are average, but those parents who are middle and upper income are able to kind of take their average kids and get better outcomes for them. So that's one of the big things that I found out is that's the difference. The other part is that as much as parents cared about their kids, they don't have the same, a lot of parents and this is borne out by the research, they don't have the same opportunities to be able to support their kids, right? A lot of them, like I have the benefit of working a regular 9-to-5 job. So I'm available to be the coach in the evening and coach on the weekends and do those kinds of things that we know contribute. It was really hard for us in that program that we ran in Camden for 20 years to get parents to come out and volunteer. It's not that they didn't want to, but a lot of them weren't working 9-to-5 jobs. They weren't available on the weekends. A lot of them were working on the weekends. A lot of them were working in the evening. A lot of them were working a late night shift from 10 p.m. till 6 a.m. So they couldn't get up on Saturday morning to come out and help us as much as they wanted to. So it's something that, right, I think there's a realization, but it's also a reality of and a lot of them, English wasn't a first language. A lot of them were first generation Americans. A lot of them, we know that they were younger. I think I told you about that in Camden. The population is younger. Younger people are less likely to volunteer than older people. And so there's a lot of obstacles to bringing the families and bringing the parents as much as they wanted to. But that's the most important thing. So those parents love their kids as much as I love mine.
Somebody asked about evaluation. Let me see. It's a question or a comment on how to determine measurable and meaningful outcome for a short-term grant. So let me see. The question says, for example, if a grant is focused on improving safety other than change in reported knowledge and comfort, how do we measure change in, let's say, safety behavior? I guess that goes to a broader question about program evaluations when it comes to grants. Can you tell us a little more about that? And, you know, is it necessary, and what types of evaluations?
Yeah, as a researcher, I'm always interested in understanding what the impact is, right, of funding or interventions. And I think we really have to back off that in philanthropy. We're not giving for a couple of reasons. One, we don't give most in our grants, we don't give enough funding to really do good evaluation. And I think we also know from from research that it takes an incredible amount of resources to get small changes. And we don't give enough funding to even pick up those changes, right? But we know that, if we're trying to do something around getting more kids to healthy weight, we're not going to be able to pick that up. We're not going to. I mean, one of the craziest things I remember, there was a, I won't say which foundations funded it, but they said in the city of Camden, they gave a couple million dollars. They were going to decrease obesity in Camden by 50%. And I was like, yeah, the only way you're going to decrease obesity in Camden by 50% is cutting the arms and legs off kids. That's the only way you're going to decrease weight, because there is no intervention that anyone has discovered that's going to be able to make that kind of impact with a couple million dollars. And I think we have to really back off these ideas of how much we think we can actually measure, and really focus more on the evaluation of what are we learning? What are we learning about how we share resources, how we engage more voices and sectors in the conversation, and really thinking about how we share those stories. And the foundation puts a lot of emphasis on research, evaluation, and learning, with really the emphasis on learning. What are we learning from this? Because we're going to learn more than being able to evaluate. Evaluation is something that takes a lot of resources, takes a lot of skills. A lot of communities don't have those resources. And I think we kind of do them a disservice when we as funders say, we want you to tell us what kind of impacts you had beyond what you learned, because they just don't have enough resources to do that well. So I could say a lot about that, but.
No, I really appreciate that, because oftentimes you hear about one of the requirements for submitting a grant proposal is having that evaluation piece. Yep. Okay, so thank you. Thank you so much, Bob, and we've learned so much. And thank you for your time. You've answered so many just a whole broad range of questions. Let me see, somebody, you have a fan. Okay, somebody wrote, not only is Bob Atkins an outstanding soccer player in person, he is an awesome lecturer and professional living an incredible mission. Congrats, Bob. Thank you for being here at CSH, and it's your friend Matt McDonald.
Well, let me just say about Dr. McDonald. I just all of you, I'm sure you know him to be a very nice person, but I warn you, do not get between him and a soccer ball. He's tough. He's tough. I've watched him, we play in the same over 35 soccer team. I've seen him destroy a lot of the hopes and dreams of a lot of the prime soccer players when he goes out there. Matt is a tough soccer player. He's a younger guy than me, but he's fun to play with. He's a tough competitor. People, you don't know the side of him that's the competitive side. Be careful. Don't ever have a soccer ball between you and him.
Yeah. Okay. Well, on that note, I really thank you. We all thank you for such a great talk about health equity and about grants, and so many of us are interested in applying and trying to learn as much as we can to write the best proposal. But thank you so much for all of the work that you continue to do, especially as a New Jerseyan, and you're doing great work with your foundation, with your program, and with the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. Thank you so very much, Bob.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, it was such a pleasure. And
thank you.
Yeah, I want to thank everybody for joining us today. And we invite you to check our website for information about our ongoing research and upcoming distinguished lecture series events for the coming year. Thank you so much, everybody. Take care. Bye, Bob.
Thank you.
Thank you.